So my name is Jamie Thompson and I am a show designer. For me, I got into lighting very early when I was very small. We used to kind of do small amateur dramatic shows and school shows, and then ended up going to the Central School of Speech and Drama and studying production lighting, and then came out and started working with a guy called Brian Leach, who kind of gave me my first opportunities in the industry, and yeah, it kind of flourished from there. Our third year project at university, a part of it was to do a negotiated task. So that was basically up to us to reach out to practitioners in the industry and work with them, or you know, try and get to work with them. So I reached out to a person called Brian Leach, who was Coldplay's lighting designer, and kind of pestered him and asked him to kind of see if he would take me on. And he agreed very, very kindly. And yeah, we got on really well. And I started working for him very regularly and kind of went from rigging lights to designing lights to then kind of designing shows. So yeah, it was quite a interesting progression. The nature of our business is pretty high tech. You know, we use a lot of very, very sophisticated kind of computer-based technology, as well as like lighting technology and video technology. So for us, keeping ahead of the advances in the industry is pretty key, because you know, you want to be able to have your show stand out from everyone else's, or at least you know, be in the same ballpark as them. So, you know, we work with a lot of manufacturers to kind of work with them to try to produce their technology and kind of see where it needs to be. And likewise, we get to play with some really cool toys along the way. So, you know, like new video screens, new lights, new lighting control desks, video servers, lots and lots of things. So yeah, it's a pretty exciting job technology-wise. There's a lot going on. Being a designer is, you know, has lots of different challenges. It's, you know, you have to create something that looks good, and that not only looks good, works within budgets, works within the size of venues. So, you know, there's lots of challenges on a day-to-day basis. But, you know, we've over time, you kind of learn to foresee them almost, and you know, create designs around that. So you kind of cut out a lot of the trauma along the way. I think my first job was touring with Joss Stone when she was kind of breaking out, very early days, and then toured with bands like Feeder and Ash and, you know, kind of small rock bands, and then kind of progressed from there really. So tour bus life is quite unique. Like so a tour bus generally, a double-decker tour bus generally has 16 berths on, so you can have 16 people. And obviously 16 people on a bus can get quite busy. But you generally, the tour bus is only for sleeping on at night and traveling to the next place. So that when we have a day off, we go into a hotel. So it's not all bad. But you know, it can get quite smelly from time to time. But you know, generally it's pretty nice. You know, there's a lot of movie watching that goes on. A few beverages, get drunk. But generally it's pretty comfortable and pretty nice. You know, especially if you find yourself on a tour with you know, a bunch of nice people, it can actually be quite enjoyable. I mean, so we created our company Mirad 7 years ago. As basically, we wanted to create a collective of designers that gave kind of up and coming designers a safe space to work in and collaborate in. So you know, we can ask questions, we can show each other designs, and and basically not have anything stolen, or, you know, and it's basically just like a collaborative workspace. But Mirad kind of takes up, you know, takes a few different forms. You know, we have a little bit of higher equipment that we rent out. We have our studio space. We have like pre-production facilities that we do a lot of programming in. And then we do a lot of design work. And then there's also the kind of being on tour side of it, which, so there is quite a few elements to it, but they all kind of combine into one almost. Generally, we will get contacted by either a manager or a band, and then we, so sometimes you get asked to pitch on a band, which will involve, you know, you submitting a design with maybe 3 to 5 other designers, or you will get approached to create a design without having to compete against anyone, which is obviously the favorable process. So you end up going out for a meeting with the manager and the band, and you discuss where they want to be, what kind of things they would like, where, you know, how much money they've got to spend, the budget. And then we'll spend, you know, a week listening to music, coming up with key elements that we think will work. And then obviously factoring in the size of venue that we have to work in. So that, you know, sometimes we work in small club venues that have, you know, 1,000 capacity, right up to stadiums, which could be 80 to 100,000 capacity. So, you know, the scope of design can be very, very different. But once we've figured out exactly what we need to do, we'll create a mood board and a reference plane that we can then, you know, go back to the band and say, is this, you know, this the kind of idea that you're after? Is this, you know, the right direction? And then from there, we'll sit down and spend, you know, anything from a couple of days to a couple of weeks, just kind of working through a design that we think will be suitable for them. So we draw this in a software called WYSIWYG, which is a very specific design program created for the industry. So we will build this in 3D and mainly in wireframe, and then we can render it out so it looks real. And you can put lights in, and you can put video screen in, and you can turn the lights on, and you can turn the video screen on, and you can make everything work. So then we can actually create very, very realistic renders of what it should look like in real life, which then we would go back to the band and say, this is what we've created, are you happy with it? And most of the time it's very positive, but obviously sometimes you have to make changes. And then from there we start discussing with hire companies, and getting prices and quotes. And once we've got the right quote for the equipment that we need, we then put it into action. So on bigger shows and arenas and stadiums, you would go into pre-production, so rehearsal facilities, and build it and rehearse for maybe a week or 2 weeks, and then take it all down and then go to your first show and do it for the first time. So, I mean, we take a lot of inspiration from YouTube and the internet. You know, it's a fountain of information and knowledge. You know, for us, like, Google image search is phenomenal because there's everything out there, and you can very much go through and just look at different bits and from that get inspiration. But, I mean, from the world around you as well, there's a lot of, you know, you can walk around churches or, you know, city streets, and sometimes, you know, something will stand out and you take a picture of it and that becomes the inspiration for a design. Or, you know, there's sometimes where, you know, maybe the music will lend itself to a certain time period that then you want to base that on, or something just clicks with you in the music and you kind of, that's the direction you feel like you might want to take it. So, you know, you can kind of theme it almost. So it's, yeah, there's, I mean, inspiration is kind of everywhere. I think it's knowing how to hone it and getting past getting past having, it can be quite overwhelming when you're starting a design, because if you have no idea of where you want to go with it, there is so much you could do, but you have to spend a bit of time looking for it and getting around the design in your head, or getting around the first initial idea. And then once you've got that, you can really kind of expand on it and create different avenues and arrive at your final destination. For us, doing stadium shows are amazing. So we worked with the script for quite a long time, and we were very lucky to play Croke Park in Dublin, which, you know, big Irish band playing a very sacred place in their home city, was amazing. And yeah, it was quite emotional in a way, you know, seeing that many people in one space, you know, it was pretty special. Being creative is pretty high up on the list, but I think also being a nice kind of happy person, really. You know, I think you it's such a social job that you kind of have to deal with people every day and meet people every day. So, you know, being quite relaxed around people is quite key. So I think it's really key to find people in the industry that are like-minded. So looking at people that have already been established in the industry and already have a career, and talking with them, but also looking at everything that you can do to get as many opportunities as you can, because experience is key. You know, being on the ground, you can read about lights and video all you want, and you can watch shows, but actually being on the ground and seeing things, you know, seeing shows and being involved in shows and learning how they work and why things are done for particular reasons is key. So yeah, I'd say try and gain as much experience as you can. I mean, in essence, you don't need any qualifications. And there's been very many very successful kind of lighting and show designers that, you know, don't have any qualifications. I think for me personally, going to university I came from quite a small rural town in Middle England, so coming to London and studying university gave me an opportunity to grow as a person and be in London. And I think London is quite a hub for creativity, and especially in this industry. So yeah, I'd say, you know, it's not essential to have qualifications, but, you know, obviously, you know, for me, getting a degree, that gave me so much more than just purely getting the degree. It gave me quite a lot of life experience. I mean, the job is based on, you know, it's very much you get a day rate most of the time. So, you know, if you're on the road, you can expect to earn anything from £150 to £500 a day, depending on the size of the job and, you know, who you're working for. But then as a designer, you get design fees. So you would then get paid for sitting and designing a show. And that, I mean, that can be from a small show, that could be £1,000, to a big show, which could be £20,000 to £40,000, depending on the artist. So, you know, it is very, very varied, the amount you can earn. But, you know, I would say, you know, it's quite a good way of generating income on the road, because you're away for so long, and generally you get looked after, you get catered for. So and your accommodation's paid for, so you get, you know, you can walk away from a tour if it's a couple of months with quite a sizable amount of income. I think working in, you know, like youth theatre, theatres, anything, like, I think volunteering in anything music wise, in any kind of music events, is key. So like any kind of council festivals, or, you know, and basically anything that involves having a lighting or a video element to it. There, you know, It's been a long time since I've done any volunteering for anything, but you know, I think there are, you know, there's a lot of companies that do offer work experience, or, you know, will take on interns, and that's a really, you know, for us, you know, we've had a couple of interns come through, and you know, for us it's great because you get to work with someone new and you're going to get to teach them all about your methods of working and your process. And I think for, you know, someone coming through, it's amazing as well because they, you know, they just get to learn a huge pot of information. Like I said, we started a company 7 years ago, and so for us that was always long term for us. So, you know, I started off, you know, hanging lights and packing trucks and that kind of stepped up to design work. And then we started our company, and the aim is to, you know, expand our company and you know, be able to take on more people and expand what we do and design more shows. And yeah, so I mean, as in terms of like career opportunities, I think if it's something that you want to do, you know, you want to stick with and you want to progress down the route, I think just kind of sticking with it and progressing in your growing in your career. Now running a company, it's really opened my eyes into running businesses, which is also something that I'm quite passionate about. But you end up having to, you manage quite large teams of people. So yeah, your skill base is, you know, quite good, you know. So, I mean, you could go into a lot of other vocations that, you know, involve working with people and, you know, running businesses and being creative. But I mean, lighting and show design is fairly specific in what it is. But yeah, I mean, it does open a few other avenues, I guess. I mean, most of this job is about being, you know, you are self-employed or freelance. So that, you know, has a blessing and a curse because it can mean that you can be really busy, but you almost then become, you know, the master of your own destiny. You can say yes or no to work. I mean, we used to work, you know, when I was touring a lot, we used to tour 9 to 10 months of the year, which was, you know, a long time to be away from home and not something that I'd like to do now. But you do get to see the world, you know, you tour all around the world, you see some amazing places. So, you know, you can be, you know, it can take up a huge amount of your time, but, you know, then also you can control how much you want to do as well. Being self-confident and being able to create a design that looks beautiful and that elevates a band's music really, really, you know, really is like, that is what this job is about.